Hey, you should check out this add-on.
Expensive!
No, it's totally free.
Why?
Why is it free or...
Why?
Oh, because it's a lot like Substance Painter.
Blender!
Yeah, I know this is Blender, but I really think it's worth checking out.
Okay, so today we're going to be learning how to make hand-painted textures in Blender using a free add-on called Ucupaint. Link's in the description. The add-on is made by Ucupumar, who is an absolute legend for making this free. Ucupaint enables a layer-based texture painting system in Blender very similar to that found in Substance Painter.
Or Quixel Mixer. And I can't recommend this add-on highly enough, especially to beginners. Because not only will it let you learn texture painting, it will also teach you how to use industry-standard, layer-based texturing systems like Substance Painter and Quixel Mixer. And the sooner you learn that, the better. Plus, it's free and it's direct. In Blender.
Now, if this video helps you out or you like the content, smash the like button and subscribe. It helps me make videos like these. Okay, on to Ucupaint. So for a simple starter project, I figured a Voltorb would be a good idea. It's not complicated to model, it's very easy to paint, and it's a Pokemon, so we all win. But in order to paint our Voltorb easily, we need to install the add-on.
Installation!
To install Ucupaint, go to Edit, Preferences, Add-ons, Install, Navigate to your plugin folder, wherever it may be, search for Ucupaint, and click Install Add-on. After a moment it will populate in the list, and click this box, to make sure it's enabled. And now that it's enabled, we need something to paint on. So let's go ahead and add a UV sphere by pressing Shift A, going to Mesh, and going down to UV sphere right now. Now, in order to get the eyebrow ridges right, we're gonna need a little more resolution. So what we're gonna do is select the UV sphere, then we're gonna hit Shift 3. And what this does is add a subdivision surface modifier that's set to 3 iterations. So this UV sphere has now been subdivided 3 times and has plenty of geometry for the sculpting we need to do. Now we can switch to sculpting mode. I have Tab for Pie Menu selected in the options, which allows me to hold Tab to bring up a pie menu to switch between modes. Saves a lot of time. Once we're in sculpt mode, we will use the draw brush, in order to smush out the eyebrows that we want. We can bring in a reference that we can see permanently by clicking in between, dragging down. This opens a new window that we can change to whatever we want. Switching to image editor, going to open, navigating to your reference image, selecting the image and clicking open image. Then to make sure our reference image stays there the entire time, we just click this little pin and there it will remain. Now I'm going to sculpt this and try and get it into the right shape. Okay, so I'm going to turn on X symmetry, and then I'm going to use the draw brush, and it's pretty much as simple is making just a couple strokes here and checking the height against our reference from the right angle. We're only adding eyebrow ridges, so once that's done, you can move on to the next step, which is
layers.
Now, the whole point of Ucupaint as an add-on is to enable layer-based texturing, which is insanely powerful. And Ucupaint makes it very simple to do. So let's select our UV sphere and let's switch over to texture paint mode. Again, I'm going to use Tab for Pie Menu to switch over to texture paint like this. Now, you'll notice that when you switch to texture paint mode, your reference disappeared. Well, it didn't disappear. We just need to go to View, Display Texture Painted UVs, turn it off, and your reference will come back. For texture painting, we would like to be in material preview mode, so hit Z or Z on your keyboard and drag down to go to material preview mode. Because we made some changes to the UV sphere, we now need to unwrap its UVs so we can paint correctly. Blender makes this really easy to do with its automatic UV unwrapping. It's not the best result, but it'll certainly be enough for us to proceed with our painting. In order to do that, we select our UV sphere, use Tab to go into edit mode, hit A on your keyboard to select all, hit U on your keyboard, and select Smart UV Project. Set the island margin to 0.01 to give us some space between our UV islands. Leave everything else the same and select OK. As you can see, the UVs look pretty awful, but for our purposes, since we're just learning, this is going to be more than enough for us to paint on. If you can't see the sidebar on the right-hand side of the 3D viewport, hit N and it'll appear. Then you can navigate to the Ucupaint tab and we can go from there. This is the About section. We're going to close it to save space, but if you want to support the developers, this is a great spot to find their information. Okay, so let's close that and then we're going to navigate to the Quick Ucupaint Node Setup button. And once we click that, it's going to ask us what kind of setup we want. Do we want a principled? Do we want a diffuse, or do we want an emission? It's common to use an emission shader for hand-painted textures because the painting shows up regardless of lighting. But since I want to render this with lighting, I'm going to leave it on principled for now, and we can make some adjustments to make it work. So I'm going to select principled, and this is what we see. Notice we have this sweet, sweet layers panel here. And to start off, we're going to go over to this plus button, and we're going to make a selection. Now I know, when you hover over this plus button for the first time, there's a lot of options. But trust me, we will make our way through them, and it'll be a snap. Now the first layer type that we want is a solid color layer. So we'll go to the plus button, and navigate to solid color, Once we do that, this pop-up will appear and we can select the solid color we would like to fill this layer. This is going to be the bottom layer of our Voltorb, so I'd like it to be white, but not pure white, something just a little bit more saturated. So I'm going to pick a slightly off-white color, maybe shift it a little into the yellow, and make it a little bit darker. When I'm happy, I'm going to select OK. Now you'll notice that our entire Voltorb is covered in this color. Next, we want to add the red top of the Voltorb. So we'll go to the same plus button, but this time we'll go to new image. This creates a new image that we can actually
actually paint on. Let's name this layer red top so that we know what it is. The channel, yeah, and the blend type, yeah, are both fine. The size of our image being 1024 by 1024, yeah, is also fine because we're just filling it with a solid color. Now, in order to get a nice clean separation between these colors, we're going to use the geometry as a mask. That means we're going to select some faces on our sphere and use them to control where the paint can go. To do that, we're going to go into edit mode, hit 1 on our numpad to go into front orthographic view, hold in the Z key and switch the viewport shading mode to wireframe. Make sure you have the selection box tool selected, yeah, and then box select the top half of your UV sphere, going from above the geometry down to the red X axis. Hold Z again and toggle back to solid viewport shading mode, and you'll see that the top half of your UV sphere has been selected all the way through. Now let's toggle back to texture paint mode, and oh no, what happened? It's gone!
Why?
Just ran into a limitation of Blender. Blender's used to texture painting being done on only one layer. And remember, before we went and selected that geometry, we had created the red top layer, but it's empty. As a result, when Blender looks at the solid shading mode, it sees absolutely nothing. In order to see our model again, all we have to do is go back to material preview mode. If you find yourself painting away and then all of a sudden something disappears, just make sure you're in material preview mode, because solid mode will render the active layer in Ucupaint, which can lead to some weird looking stuff, and I'll show you what I mean in a minute. Now, since we selected some geometry to mask off, we want to use this button up, which is the paint mask button. Turning this on makes it so that the faces we have selected will be available to paint, while the ones we didn't select won't get any paint on them at all. Now I'm going to navigate down to my tool tab, that has all of my brush information, including its size, strength, and color. You'll find this up at the top here also. Now I'm going to select my primary color, and then I'll use the eyedropper tool to color pick the mid-tone from my reference. That's this one. You could also do this by eye, whatever floats your boat. Once I've picked my color, I can either paint it in by hand using the brush tool, just like this, or I can use the fill tool, making sure it's set to color and not gradient, in order to flood the top of it with this color, which I'm gonna do. Okay, now we got the top half of our Voltorb colored in, we can move on to adding some lines. Now before we go any further, I'm gonna turn the metallic and the roughness all the way up here, just to help saturate the colors some more and make it less reflective. Turning up the metallic in this case only serves to help saturate the colors because our roughness is cranked all the way up. Let's also quickly shut off face masking, so we can work on the whole object. Next, we'll create another new image. The default settings here again are totally fine, we're just adding some black lines to the middle. Let's call this layer middle lines. Now let's navigate to the top color here and we're gonna drop it down to black. We can change the radius or size of our brush with this slider, or we can hold in the F key and drag our mouse to resize it. Holding Shift F and dragging our mouse will instead change the strength. For the size, we want something pretty small, so I'm gonna go with around 3 pixels. Now I'll go to the stroke menu here and change my stroke type to a line. This'll let me drag out a perfectly straight line across my object. Once I've selected line as my stroke type, I'll press 1 on my numpad to go into front orthographic view, and I'll draw my stroke. And you'll notice that when I draw my stroke in this way, and I turn my model, it cuts off about halfway through. There are some options at the bottom of the tool menu, that let us get around this. Let's shut off both occlude and backface culling. Try making that same line again. Just like magic, it's gone all the way through. This is because by shutting off occlude, we're telling Blender that we don't care that the faces can't be seen by the camera, we want to paint on them anyway. And backface culling hides the insides of objects, so by shutting this off, we can be sure we'll be painting all the way through our object. Now this next part is important, and I mean really important. Do not forget to turn these back on. It will drive you crazy if you forget. So what we can do is hover over them, right click, and select Add to Quick Favorites. By adding both of them, we can quickly check to see if they're on or not by pressing Q in the viewport. Now I want to add the illusion of a bevel, so I'm going to add another new image layer. Again, the settings are perfectly fine. Let's call this one Fake Bevel and click OK. Again, I want to paint all the way through my model, so let's make sure occlude and backface culling are both off. Let's increase the size of our brush just a little bit, holding down the F key and moving our mouse to the right. Then let's decrease the opacity by holding Shift F and moving our mouse to the left. Probably about 30% is going to be good. Then, since our stroke is still set to line, we can draw another line all the way across, and it will create the illusion of a bit of depth. I want to do one more line, so I'll make my brush a little bit bigger, hold F and drag to the right, and I'll keep the opacity the same and just draw one more line across my object. As you can see, it gives the illusion of a split. In order to give a little bit more volume to our sphere, we're going to add a dust layer to the top. Dust is one of the options in this massive list of layers, and it acts as a mask, meaning that it hides or lets through certain information. In our case, we want to use it to simulate light from above to help give some more form. Now I'll explain how this works. I'll create a layer that's just a dust layer. After a moment, you'll see that our object is covered in black, except for a dusting of white on top, where the object curves. And granted, this isn't useful to us as a paint layer. However, the way masks work is that black hides information and white lets information through, which means that we can use this to control a certain color. So let's do that. I'm going to create a new layer. I'm going to pick solid color because this is the color I want to poke through the mask. I'll open up the color option.
Yeah.
Use the color picker.
Yeah.
To pick the lighter color on my reference. Now I'm going to go down to the mask section.
Yeah.
Open it up and once again we find dust.
Yeah.
For now we can leave these options as they are and just click OK. The result will take a moment because Blender is baking information from your object that it's then using to determine the position of the dust. And then it's turning the result into an image that we can paint or manipulate. And if that's confusing for you right now, don't worry about it. We'll talk about baking in a different video. For our purposes, Ucupaint makes this ridiculously simple, so we don't really have to worry about it.
Yay!
When it's finished, you can see that our lighter color is only showing through in the areas that were white on the black and white mask. And we can verify this by going to preview mode,
yeah,
selecting the drop-down menu,
yeah,
and going to specific mask or override. When you do that, it'll show you the mask that's controlling the color. I'm not super happy with the default result here, so we're going to manipulate it a bit and smooth it out and make it look better. First, let's make sure occlude and backface color are turned back on. That was close. Alright, let's start by renaming this layer Fake Top Light. I want to smooth out the transition between the lighter color and the darker color, so in order to do that, I'm going to use the Blur tool.
Yeah.
Just run it over the edges of the lighter color to help smooth them out. If I switch to the mask preview mode, you can see exactly what's happening when I use this soften brush on the mask. And with just a little bit of smoothing, it looks a lot better. And now I think it's time to outline the eyes. First, we'll make a new image layer. Let's name it Eye Outline. Let's make sure to switch back to our brush tool,
yeah,
and turn our opacity all the way back to full. Similar to before, we're going to set our brush size fairly small, around 3 pixels, and set it to black. I want to make sure I change my stroke back to space,
yeah,
which is the default brush mode. And in order to make it nice and smooth, I'm going to turn on Stabilize Stroke and turn it up to about maybe 75 pixels.
Yeah.
Then using my reference, I'm just going to carefully draw the eyes. I'm going to speed this up for the video, but if you're following along, just take your time until you're happy with it. Another awesome feature of Ucupaint is this toggle eraser button. It makes it super quick to toggle between drawing and erasing. I recommend right-clicking and adding it to your quick favorites as well. Once I'm satisfied with the outlines, I'll create a new image layer. I will call it Eye Fill, and I'm going to paint in the whites of the eyes. I want this to be under my eye outlines though, so I will select the layer and then click this down arrow to move it into the right spot. So I'll select the eye color here, adjust it a little bit, and then start filling in the eyes. I left my stroke type on line, so I'm just going to change that back to space now. I'll just switch back to the eye outline layer, and I'm going to fill in the pupils here. Looks as if I made this second Voltorb a bit wider than the first one, so he's a little oddly spaced, but that's alright. Don't worry, Voltorb, it's good to be a wide boy. Now I want to start adding highlights, which means we need to pick a direction for the light. We might as well just use the one that's in our reference. So I'm going to quickly model an arrow that shows the direction that the light is pointing. Here we go, super speedy fast! And I'll just copy my reference's lighting as best I can. There, that should do just fine. Okay, first up is the soft highlights, so we're going to create a new image layer once again. Let's call it soft highlights. Now, our light is coming from only one side of our Voltorb, so we want to make sure that we shut X symmetry off by clicking this right here. Now, I'm just going to orient my camera so that I can look at the object where the light is hitting it. I'll shut off my light angle reference, make sure that I have my brush tool selected, make my brush much, much larger, bring down the opacity, and I'm going to go to fall off,
yeah,
and I'm going to select this pointy one.
Yeah.
This is actually going to make the brush very, very soft, which is exactly what we want for a broad, soft highlight. Alright, I'm just going to click around a couple of times until I'm satisfied with the way it looks. If I'm not happy with the edges, I will use the soften tool,
yeah,
or the smudge tool,
yeah,
to change the boundaries and make it look a little smoother. Then I'm going to add one more new image layer. I'll call it Specular Highlight. I'll select a lighter color, reduce my brush size, and increase my opacity. And I'm just going to aim the specular highlight for the center of the surface that the light is hitting. I'm also quickly just adding a little more blur to the specular highlight on top. And with that, we're onto the home stretch. The last things we need to do are just a little extra shadow for some more definition. So we're going to create two layers. First, let's create a new layer. We call it Eye Shadow. In the blend mode section,
yeah,
change the mode to multiply. We're also going to bring down the layer opacity,
yeah,
to about 35%. Then, with the Eye Shadow layer selected, click on this little disclosure triangle,
right, yeah,
and select Duplicate Layer.
Yeah.
Rename this layer to Eyebrow Shadow. And finally, create one more layer, but this time a solid color layer, and somewhere in the cool blues. Something like this. Rename this layer to Shadow Gradient. Navigate down to the mask section,
yeah,
and select Gradient.
Yeah.
By default, it will be set to UV, but in order for it to look right, we're gonna switch it to Object,
and then press OK.
You'll notice that it generates on the side, but don't worry about that, we'll be able to fix it in a second. First, we wanna go to the blend mode,
yeah,
and change it to Multiply.
Yeah.
Then, we wanna reduce the opacity,
yeah,
just to about 89, around 85, somewhere in there. Then we're gonna click this little triangle on this mask,
right,
yeah, and do the same thing to the vector.
Yeah.
This is gonna let us change the rotation of our gradient, which is what we want, because we want our shadow to match our light reference. So I'm going to place my mouse in this middle one here, which is the Y rotation value, and I'm going to turn it to about 33 degrees. Okay, that looks pretty good. Now for the finishing touches, which is a bit of shadow on the eyes and a bit of shadow on the eyebrows. For this, I ended up turning the layer's opacity back up to 1, and just adjusting the brush as I went. Because it sets a multiply, I'm just color picking the color I'm painting on top of, and that'll work reasonably well as the shadow color. I'm just going to paint these in to give it a little bit of volume, and I'll speed that up here a little bit. I'm noticing that our Voltorb is looking a little pink. I'd like him to be a little more red. So one of the things we could do is go back to our layer where we painted the red on top. Good thing we called it red top. And we can click this little cog to open up a menu with all sorts of modifications. We are interested in hue, saturation, right? And we're just going to increase the saturation and decrease the value a little bit until I like what I see. And there it is. We made a Voltorb. And not only did we make a Voltorb, but we learned the basics of texture painting and layer-based texture painting in Blender. This doesn't even come close to showing you all you can do with Ucupaint. It's insane. I'm cooking up another video where you can learn to use Ucupaint to make procedural stylized textures. Something like this. You get one, and you get one, and you get one. So keep your eyes peeled for that. An extra special thanks to my patrons. I couldn't do this without you. What's that? You're not part of the Deuces Club? Well, you are now. Thank you to the Deuces Club members for always sticking around to the end of my videos. And if you want to join the Deuces Club member list, all you gotta do is comment Deuces down below. Thank you so much for watching. I hope this helped, and I will see you in the next one. Deuces.